And now we are crossing over from Utah to Boston. And Professor Mark Pachanov will give a talk about micromechanics. Oh, sorry, where is it? Yeah, particular for austenitic steel and micromechanics aspects of the fatigue.
Okay, thank you. So my presentation is on the fatigue of steel, and I would like to demonstrate how the science of micromechanics enters this old subject and clarifies a few things. So I have two co-authors. I would like specifically to mention Professor Mishakin from Nizhny Novgorod, who did all the experimental work. Okay, so we're talking about the austenitic steel, and we're talking about low cycle fatigue rather than high cycle fatigue. And the difference is that in strain control tests, high cycle fatigue starts at strain ranges smaller than 0.5%. And if they are larger than 0.5%, we have low cycle fatigue. So we're talking about low cycle fatigue. So the goal is to monitor microcracking process, the damage process. And the experiments, I will not describe them in detail. They have been described in a couple of papers, and I'm not an experimentalist. So just to give you some idea that we had several fixed strain ranges from 0.5% to 1.4%, and strain ratio, which indicates whether we change the sign of the load, is zero, which means that it was tension unloading, tension unloading without compression, without going into compression. So much about experiments. And so what are the main features of the evolution of microstructure? There are two main processes during the low cycle fatigue: phase transformations into martensitic, alpha prime martensitic phase from the austenitic phase, and then microcracking. Also, we have some secondary processes like transformation from gamma to martensitic phase that goes into, that has some intermediate stage of epsilon phase, which is less stable and quickly transforms into martensite. And also, we have a change of texture, a slight change of texture of orientations of gamma crystals and some other processes, but they are secondary. The first two are the major ones, phase transformations and microcracking. Okay, so phase transformations usually result in appearance of martensitic particles that have irregular shapes, like shown here. And they constitute magnetic contrast with the austenitic phase. Austenitic phase, the basic one, the matrix, is paramagnetic, whereas the martensitic phase is ferromagnetic. So we have magnetic contrast, and we also have, just a moment, why doesn't it work? Yeah, we also have elastic contrast. The elastic contrast between austenite and martensite is relatively weak, weak to moderate, I would say. We will talk about it a bit later. So microcracks, as far as microcracks are concerned, that's a typical microphotograph of microcracks. What I would like to say is that phase transformations and microcracking are interrelated. They're interrelated. The mechanism of interrelation is that phase transformations produce compressive stresses because they want to increase the volume of particles. So they produce compressive stresses, and these stresses suppress cracking. Okay, so this is these are the main features of microstructure evolution and the low cycle fatigue. So how do we monitor it? So what are the monitoring tools? Well, we can monitor effective elastic constants through the wave velocities, and we can monitor volume fraction of martensite through the eddy current data. So eddy current data produces just volume fraction of martensite. No information, for example, about their shapes, about the shapes of martensite particles. So when we talk about effective elastic constants, since the changes of these constants are quite small, we need high accuracy measurements. Now, high accuracy measurements are a non-trivial thing for the following reason. Usually, let's say that we are discussing a metal sheet. Then the wave velocity that we want to measure is measured as the ratio of thickness to propagation time. Now, as far as thickness, as far as propagation time is concerned, it can be measured highly accurately, up to 1 nanosecond accuracy. But the thickness is a difficult story. It's difficult to measure thickness more or less accurately. First of all, there is such thing as surface roughness. And surface roughness makes determination of thickness kind of questionable. Also, one of the sides in practical applications, one of the sides of the sheet may not be accessible. So inaccuracies in measuring of thickness is a major factor that limits the accuracy of measurement of elastic constants. And I would like to stress again that we really need very high accuracy. So how do we achieve this? Well, there is such a thing as Poisson's ratio. And for the Poisson's ratio, the thickness goes away, it cancels out. The Poisson's ratio, as implied by the wave velocities, can be expressed only in terms of the propagation time of the two kinds of waves, of the longitudinal wave and of the shear wave. So these propagation times can be measured very accurately, as I've said. And as a result, Poisson's ratio can be monitored very accurately. And in fact, that's the only elastic constant that we can use reliably with high accuracy. Okay, so we would like to monitor the change of Poisson's ratio as compared to the Poisson's ratio at the unloaded state. This unloaded state is kind of a reference value that in practical applications can be obtained from those parts of the structure that have not experienced any loading. So the problem is that Poisson's ratio is affected not only by microcracking, and this is what we want. This is what we want to monitor, the delta nu C, which is due to damage. But Poisson's ratio is also affected by the martensitic phase. And so we need to separate the two effects. How do we do it? Well, first of all, how different is the Poisson's ratio of martensitic phase from Poisson's ratio of the austenitic phase? So that, for example, is this delta nu martensitic substantial, the thing that we want to subtract from the overall change of Poisson's ratio? Well, let's take a look. First of all, if one takes a look at various handbooks, it's difficult to find information on elastic constants, in particular Poisson's ratio of the martensitic phase. At least we could not find it. So can we estimate it in some way? Well, let's recall Voigt and Roy's bounds for a mixture. Let's say that we have a mixture of two materials and the most rude bounds of the zeroth order, are the ones of Voigt and Roy's. They apply to any microstructure, and therefore the width of these bounds is generally may generally be quite quite large. But if the contrast between the properties is not very large, these bounds are relatively useful. So if we have these bounds apply either to shear modulus or to bulk modulus. So let's call L either of these two moduli. And so we have Feucht bound and we have Royce bound. Usually they're used this way. You have knowledge of each of the knowledge on each of the faces, the volume fractions and properties, and you want to estimate the effective properties. But let's take a look at these bounds in the opposite direction, so to say. Let us say that we know the effective properties for two different combinations marked by star and by zero of the faces. And then we can extract the values of these moduli for each of the faces, for each of the constituents. We can do it either from Royce bounds or from Feucht bounds. So if we do this algebra, this is what we obtain in Feucht approximation and in Royce approximation. These bounds, however, these values, however, do not constitute bounds for the properties of constituents. Feucht and Royce bounds do constitute bounds for the effective properties, but if you extract the properties of the constituents from the effective properties, these properties of the constituents, these values are not bounds, but they nevertheless provide some insight into what kind of values we have. So doing this algebra, this is what we obtain. We can actually extract the elastic properties of each of the faces. And in particular, we're interested in Poisson's ratio. And what we see here, I marked it by red, the Poisson's ratio of the martensitic phase and of the matrix of the austenitic phase. And you can see a substantial difference between 0.35 and 0.29. This is a substantial difference. So indeed, we have to take the contribution of the martensitic phase into Poisson's ratio into account. We have to subtract. And so there is something to subtract. So first of all, what we can see is that Poisson's ratio of the martensitic phase is larger than Poisson's ratio of the austenitic phase. And this means that as martensite content grows, the effective Poisson's ratio increases. Microcracking, on the other hand, has the opposite effect. The effective Poisson's ratio due to microcracking decreases. So the larger the crack density, the smaller the Poisson's ratio. So these two factors work in opposite directions. Now we can understand the experimental data. This is an interesting stuff. This is how Poisson's ratio changes during the three stages of the fatigue. The first stage is quite short, typically several hundred cycles. It's called incubation stage, green one. Now, what we have after that, the yellow oval, which is the stage number two, at which martensite grows quite intensely, but microcracking is not observed, or almost not observed. What we see is relatively rapid increase of the Poisson's ratio. Now, this stage is followed by the stage three, at which martensite continues to grow, but it is now accompanied by microcracking. And what we see is that the rate of growth of martensite slows down. So the micromechanics considerations, as we see, allow us to understand this picture, these three regimes. Okay, so this is our task, to subtract the change of Poisson's ratio due to martensite from the acoustically measured overall change in order to obtain the change due to microcracking. something that we want to monitor. So how do we estimate it? We estimate it the following way. From this yellow stage, from stage number two, what we see in this stage is that the increase of Poisson's ratio is approximately proportional to the volume fraction of the Mertens size, with the coefficient of proportionality for this given steel approximately 0.12. So we extrapolate this dependence to stage three, and then the change of Poisson's ratio due to damage takes this form. It's acoustically measured thing minus K, this coefficient 0.12, times the volume fraction, change of the volume fraction of Mertens site that is obtained from the eddy current data. Now, there is one fine point that the effect of Mertens site on the elastic properties depends not only on its volume fraction, but also on the shape of the Mertens site particles. But it can be shown that if the elastic contrast is small to moderate, then the shape effects are actually quite small because the shape effects are proportional to the contrast of elastic properties squared. This is a relatively fresh result. I will not go through its derivation. It is in our book with Dr. Sevastianov that has been published by Springer in 2018, that the effect of shapes on the elastic properties is proportional to the contrast of properties squared. In our case, what we see is that the contrast is relatively weak, so the effect of shapes can be ignored and things can be stated just in terms of volume fraction of the Mertens site. Okay, by the way, I just wanted to show this general result from micromechanics. H is the contribution, compliance contribution tensor of an inclusion. And the first parenthesis is the dimensionless measure of the elastic contrast. In the second, in the bracket, what we have is the sum of the unit fourth rank tensor plus P, which is Hill's tensor, the only quantity that reflects the shapes, times again the measure of the elastic contrast. So what we see is that the effect of shapes enters proportionally to the contrast squared. Okay, so this is our basic relation. And this value can be delta nu due to damage can be used to extract information on microcrack density now, because we have this usual relation, how Poisson's ratio changes due to microcracking. This is a classical result from the effective properties of cracked media. And we can solve it for the microcrack density. And this is the expression for the crack density. And now if we use all this stuff to estimate the change of the, to estimate the microcrack density at the fracture point. The fracture point is defined as appearance of a macrocrack of about 1 millimeter long. So what we see is that as the strain range, the amplitude of load increases, the critical value, this is the last column in red, the critical value of the crack density at which fracture occurs increases. So the critical value of micro, so the value of the crack density at the fracture point cannot be used as a criterion of fracture. So by the way, before going further, I would like just to make a very short comment without spending too much time on it. What is actually the crack density that we're using and extracting? The usual definition of the crack density assumes that the cracks are circular. A, K are radii of the penny-shaped cracks. However, for non-circular cracks, it's not really defined. So what are we extracting? We're actually extracting the density of fictitious set of circular cracks that produces the same effect. And how is it related to the actual microgeometries? This is a difficult problem that is in the process of development, I would say. Some progress has been done in this direction. It's reflected in our book of 2018 that I already mentioned. And this is just one example when you can make this extension of the crack density to non-circular cracks explicit. Generally speaking, I would like to say that we can use the crack density as implied by Poisson's ratio without linking it to crack geometry. For our purposes, it's actually not necessary. So, what I would like to add to end this kind of small remark is that this is a typical story in material science. People see cracks that look like this, and they say crack density. So what is this crack density? There are no circular cracks, no penny-shaped cracks. So people nevertheless use it. And well, that was just a small remark. So let's move on. So, so this is what we have, the table. And so how, first of all, how do we, I have to skip a couple of points. How do we explain, that the crack density at the fracture point increases with strain amplitude? Well, when strain amplitude is increased, then martensite production increases, and this increases compressive stresses. And this suppresses crack propagation and crack coalescence. And this means that we encourage diffuse crack growth. And this means that crack density goes up. This is the explanation provided by micromechanics considerations. Okay, can we try to set up a fracture criterion? Well, we just discussed that the crack density cannot be used, its value cannot be used as a fracture criterion because with increasing strain amplitude, the crack density at the fracture point increases. So it's not a fracture criterion. So what is the problem? The problem is that first of all, we cannot incorporate the amplitude of loading into the fracture criterion because the loading history may not always be known. So, but footprint left by the loading history on the current state, one of the footprints, is that the slight anisotropy that the texture usually has due to technological processes like rolling, this slight anisotropy changes. And these changes are highly sensitive to the strain range. And so we introduce the anisotropy indicator into the fracture criterion. Namely, the anisotropy indicator is introduced again in terms of, it can be measured in terms of the propagation times of the waves. This means highly accurately. And so what I would like to show is that the fracture criterion that we proposed that incorporates the change, this is the vertical axis that goes down, change of the Poisson's ratio due to damage. And horizontal axis is the change of the anisotropy parameter. And this red zone is kind of a danger zone. What we see is the evolution corresponding to different strain ranges, different strain amplitudes, and the end point, the point of fracture, fall into this relatively narrow zone. So it seems that, of course, more testing is necessary, but it seems that the fracture criterion can be formulated in terms of a critical combination of the microcrack density and anisotropy change. So this is the fracture criterion, and it's in terms of these two quantities. One of them reflects microcracking, and another one, the change of texture, and both are measured acoustically with high accuracy because they are independent of the thickness. All right, and so just one general comment at the end that we are discussing things, we have been discussing things in terms of volume average parameters. A is the effective anisotropy. Poisson's ratio is the effective elastic constant. Effective means volume average, and crack density is volume average. Everything is volume averages. Are they appropriate for fracture prediction, actually? Generally not, because for example, if we have clustering of cracks, this clustering almost does not affect the effective elastic properties, but it's a very important thing for fracture, of course. However, in our case, when we have high level of compressive stresses due to phase transformation into martensite, compressive stresses suppress crack propagation, and so microcracking has diffused character. Clustering is suppressed. And this justifies consideration in terms of volume averages. Although in general, it's not a good idea. But in our case, low cycle fatigue, it seems to work. So this is a concluding remark that microcracking, micromechanics provides some useful insights into the micro level mechanics of fatigue. It explains the behavior and it provides the criterion of fracture. And this is done by non-destructive tools, acoustic and eddy current. And that's all.
Okay. Thank you very much for your presentation. Now it's time for questions.
We have a question. 1 second.
May I ask?
Yes, yeah. Of course, Professor Freyden.
Yeah. Mark, thank you very much. To my knowledge, this is first attempt to couple phase transformation and microion and damage in mechanics of solids and micromechanics. It's really very interesting. But two questions. First of all, why do we have phase transformation and low fatigue loading? Because initially, why do we have phase transformation? First question.
Phase transformation is simply observed experimentally.
Oh, so just this is a given fact.
This has been observed for tens of years. Yeah, it's not anything new.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's only for metastable steels of this kind, not for others.
Yeah, of course. And at the beginning, maybe I didn't say it, maybe I did not emphasize it sufficiently, that in the beginning I said that all we have done relates to the specific steel. All the numerical values of the coefficients and so on. This is the specific austenitic steel number, 321, whatever it is. Of course.
Yeah. So is it initially in the metastable state? Why cyclic loading with very small strains produce phase transformation? This is a question.
Strains are not so small. The strain range was in between zero, the amplitude was between 0.5, half of a percent, and 1.4%. This is a very substantial strain range. So it's a low cycle fatigue. Actually, if we're talking about high cycle fatigue, when we have tens or hundreds of thousands of cycles, then the amplitude will be typically 0.2, 0.3% strain range. So we have relatively high strain range, large strains.
Mm-hmm. And second question to give time to other people. Could you repeat what is a fracture? Do we have fracture criterion and how you... What is your formulation, final formulation?
Okay, here it is.
Very important story.
Yeah, just a moment. Yeah, this is the fracture criterion. This fracture criterion is essentially an equation of a straight line. I didn't put it in this picture. It's just a straight line. So the horizontal equation of a straight line. The horizontal line is the change of the anisotropy parameter as defined. You can see the definition. It can be measured highly accurately because it's measured in terms of the propagation times and thickness is not involved. And vertical axis is the change of the Poisson's ratio, the part of the Poisson's ratio due to damage. This part due to damage is obtained from the total change of the Poisson's ratio as determined by the acoustic data minus the contribution from the martensitic growth. And the contribution from the martensitic growth can be estimated in terms of volume fraction, the martensite, because the shape effects of the martensitic particles, shape effects can be ignored because the contrast of properties is small. I would like to use this chance answering your question to attract attention to this fact, which I think may not have been noticed much. It's a relatively fresh result that we didn't publish it in a separate paper. It wasn't the book. Look, the compliance contribution enters, the compliance contribution has such a structure that the only tensor that reflects shape is this P tensor, Hill's tensor, and it comes in product with contrast squared. So that's why the shape effect can be ignored. And this is, I think, an interesting insight provided by micromechanics considerations, that when we discuss the contribution of the martensite into the effective elastic properties, we can ignore the shapes. Only volume fraction is important. And it's exactly volume fraction that you extract from the eddy current data.
Thank you.
And yeah, we have time for just one or two small questions, just 3 minutes till the next presentation.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure. And then I think we had one more from the hall, but first you, Professor Gadeshwar.
Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you, Mark, for a very interesting presentation and the results. And my question is it possible to extend this theory for the other materials, not only metallic materials?
Good question. I don't know what to say. you mean other metals that do not have the phase transformation or... I think, Irina, that I have to be a bit skeptical for this reason. Let me again emphasize this point, that there is certain direction of thought that the process of fracture can be monitored by changes of the elastic properties. Unfortunately, generally, this cannot be done because clustering effective elastic properties are not sensitive to clustering, whereas fracture is very strongly affected by clustering. And in our specific case of the specific material where we have martensitic transformation, we have high compressive stresses. And compressive stresses suppress clustering. And then the volume average quantities, like effective elastic constants, become relevant. And we can monitor fracture process in terms of volume average quantities, like effective elastic properties. So generally, I think I would be a bit skeptical about monitoring fracture process in terms of the elastic constants. But if you have compressive stresses, then it becomes possible.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
and?
So may I ask a question? Hello?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Mark, thank you very much for your very nice presentation. I have a couple of things. I'm afraid I cannot agree with you in the context of big difference in Poisson ratio of martensitic and austenitic phases. So in fact, you can measure properties of martensite just using cryogenic treatment of the specimen. So just if you put it in liquid nitrogen for 3 days, it will be completely martensitic. And second, why didn't you use measurement of electrical conductivity? Difference between martensite and austenite is about 20%, so it's quite noticeable.
Yeah, this is another way to do it, but the eddy current method is also provides the same information. As far as the cryogenic treatment and the way to measure it through the cryogenic cooling for 3 days, I wasn't aware of it. So thank you for pointing it out.
Okay, yes.
Thank you very much for the question. Thank you very much for the presentation, Professor Kashanov.